again.
How are you guys doing?
Good.
All right, good to hear. So we were going to come and round on Katie now. I brought my attending with me. We like to bring the team into the room here at the Children's Hospital and do family-centered rounding. I'm going to go ahead and catch him up to speed and just kind of walk through Katie's story, what brought her into the hospital. And then while we have you here, we also like to talk about a diagnosis and treatment plan.
Okay.
All right. So we can go ahead and get started. So this is Katie. She is a previously healthy 5-year-old girl. She presented to our emergency department because she had had 5 days of fever at home. She also had a rash on her trunk that started, or on her body, on her chest and belly. It started 3 days prior to admission. Per mom, it sounds like she was having daily fevers to about 103. The highest temperature she had was 104, and that was prior to bringing her into the emergency department. You had been giving her children's Motrin at home, but her fevers hadn't really been responding. The rash hasn't seemed to bother Katie. It's red, but not itchy. You also noted that she's had a little bit of a runny nose and sore throat, and she really hasn't been acting quite like herself. She's been tired. Her appetite has been down, though she has been keeping up with fluids at home, which is good. She's been using the bathroom normally, though she was complaining of some belly pain prior to you bringing her into the emergency department. You also noted that her eyes were a little red and her hands seemed a little puffy to you. So in the emergency department, Katie was noted to be febrile to 102.3. Her vital signs upon presentation included a blood pressure of 100 over 70, a heart rate of 120, which is a little high. Typically with kids, when we see the heart rate a little elevated, we think of things like fever, sometimes infection, and otherwise if they're just not drinking enough fluids. She also had a respiratory rate of 22, which is normal, and an oxygen level of 99%, which is near perfect. And so we also did some blood work on her when she presented. We noticed that she had a high white blood cell count of 16. Normally that suggests some sort of infectious process. We also measured two important markers in the blood. They're called inflammatory markers. These are called the ESR and the CRP. We noticed that Katie had elevations in both of those. It was 75 and 15 respectively. So again, some sort of inflammatory process or some sort of infection that's been getting to her the last couple days. We also checked her urine as well because we wanted to rule out any infections. We found that she had 12 white blood cells in the urine, and normally that would suggest to us, again, some sort of infection or urinary tract infection, but we didn't see any bacteria in the urine, which makes us think of another cause, which we'll get to in a little bit. We also gave Katie some fluids in the emergency department. She got a 20 cc per kilogram bolus, which helped bring her heart rate down, and we gave her some Tylenol to treat the fever. I'd like to talk about some past history now. So Katie, as I mentioned, has been previously healthy. She hasn't had any prior hospitalizations. She did have a tonsillectomy and adenoidectomy in 2014 that was uneventful. She was seen in the emergency department at 2 years of age for a febrile seizure. She hasn't had any seizure episodes since. She has no allergies to any medicines, and other than the Motrin, she just takes a daily multivitamin at home. Her vaccines, including influenza, are up to date this year. For family history, Katie has 3 siblings, a healthy 8-year-old sister, a 6-year-old sister with asthma and eczema, and a healthy 3-year-old brother. Her mom is healthy, and it was noted that her father has depression, but is well treated with medication and therapy. Katie lives at home with these 3 siblings and her parents. There are no guns in the home and no smokers. She's currently enrolled in a 5-day-a-week preschool program, and there's no pets in the home. So we talked about some of the symptoms that Katie has had, but I also like to mention important symptoms that Katie hasn't had as well, part of our review of systems. So notably, she hasn't had any ear pain, no changes in her voice, no cough, wheezing or shortness of breath, no vomiting or diarrhea, no pain or burning when using the bathroom, and no headaches. On physical examination, Katie remained febrile this morning at 101 despite the Tylenol. Her heart rate has come down to 100, and the rest of her vital signs have been stable since admission. Generally, we can see that Katie appears quite tired. However, this morning she was appropriately responsive on exam. We can see she's well-developed, well-nourished, and non-toxic appearing. On head and neck exam, it was noted that her eyes were quite red, though I didn't appreciate any discharge. Her eye movements were appropriately intact, as were her pupillary reactions. Her ear canals were clear, and her inner ear membranes weren't red, and there was no opacification or signs that might suggest an ear infection. She also had a little bit of a runny nose, but it was clear. And notably, her throat was quite red, as was her tongue. It almost had a strawberry color to it. And we can see she has red lips. They appear dry and cracked in the corners. On neck exam, I could feel some little lymph nodes on the neck, or sometimes the little kind of lumps and bumps that pop up during infection. They were 1 to 2 centimeters in size. Katie's heart was regular. There were no murmurs or extra sounds. Her lungs were clear on both sides, and she was moving air very well. However, I did notice some swelling in her hands this morning on exam. Her belly was soft and non-tender, and her joints were not swollen. They weren't warm. There was no tenderness. And lastly, on skin exam, it was noted that she had that diffuse red rash that we were talking about earlier. I would call it a morbilliform rash. Typically, we describe rashes by how they look and how they feel. Some areas of the rash were flat and other areas felt a little more bumpy in nature, so we would call that morbilliform. That was on her chest, back, and belly, but there was no overlying scale or crust, and she was also noted to have red palms. So I'd like to kind of tie all of this together. So basically, in summary, Katie is a previously healthy 5-year-old girl. She's presenting with prolonged fever, a rash, red eyes, swelling of her hands, redness of the palms, and she's also got some lymph nodes in her neck. And this kind of summary of symptoms makes us think of a disease called Kawasaki's, which is the diagnosis that we'd like to make here. And I wanted to take some time to explain to you what Kawasaki's is. So essentially, it's a vasculitis, meaning that there's inflammation in the small blood vessels. And unfortunately, we don't have a great explanation for what causes it or why it happens, which can be really frustrating for families when they're in the hospital. However, we do hear oftentimes that kids might present with symptoms of a cold, or they might have fever for several days. Typically, other signs include the red eyes, the puffiness in the hands and feet, the rash on the body. Those all make us think of the diagnosis. So as I mentioned, we also sometimes do blood work to confirm suspicions of Kawasaki's. Katie had the white blood cell count that we talked about and the high inflammatory markers. And because there's inflammation in the vessels, we want to make sure that the very small blood vessels that surround her heart are healthy and that we can prevent any complications in the future. So though we don't know what causes it, we have ways to treat it and prevent those complications. Okay, so with that, we'd like to go ahead and set up a plan moving forward. The first thing that we'd like to do is go ahead and order an ultrasound of Katie's heart. It's called an echo, and that's just a very simple study that we can do in the event that we need to do future studies. This will serve as Katie's baseline that we have for comparison. And then there's two medications that we would like to go ahead and start. The first one is called IVIG, or IV immune globulin. This is the medication that we can give her through her IV, okay? And then we'll also give her aspirin as well while she's here. We'll likely continue her fluids, at least until she's feeling better and eating and drinking more normally. We're going to continue to monitor her fever, her vital signs, and hopefully provide you guys with whatever other care she might need while she's here. Okay. Are there any questions we can answer for you at the moment?
No, not right now. I think you explained a lot of things, and I also got the chance to ask some questions.
Great.
Last night.
Great. Thank you. Well, thank you so much.